Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another program of your Council on Aging. Would you all please rise and join with us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, with liberty for all.
Francine, would you please call the roll?
Commissioner Borgi?
Here.
Commissioner Dukoski?
Here.
Commissioner Kam? Commissioner Norkin?
Here.
Commissioner Poprock is absent. Commissioner Shentes?
Here.
Commissioner Sheridan?
Here.
Commissioner Silberberg is absent, and Commissioner Steiner is absent. Thank you.
Thank you, Francine. Before we get into public comments, I'd like to make a few remarks. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon again. Another welcome to the broadcast of the Thousand Oaks Council on Aging. This will be our last broadcast until next fall. We will return on September 5 with a new season of highly interesting and informative programs. The September program will feature Hospice of the Camino and Senior Deputy Larry Logan of the Thousand Oaks Police Department, who will talk about fraud, elder abuse, and identity theft. During the past year, we have brought before our microphones and cameras speakers on affordable housing, medication, Medicare Part D, transportation, independent living, caregiving, senior housing, and just about anything that impacts seniors. We will continue to do so in the future, but we need the cooperation of all the seniors in this area to tell us about what their needs are. To make it easier for seniors to tell us what their needs and concerns are, this commission has formed an outreach committee to establish a speakers bureau made up of members of the commission and experts in the various fields of senior concerns who will be available to come to various senior venues to speak about senior issues and at the same time get their inputs. Before we go on with this meeting, I have some sad news to present. I was informed the other day that Joy Hagestad had passed away. Joy had been a member of this commission and was best known for her association with the Seniors Concerns Thrift Shop and Bargain Boutique. She was also a recipient of the Senior of the Year Award. She would be missed by many other people. We'd also like to send Commissioner Mel Silberberg a get-well message. He underwent recent surgery for a hip replacement, and we hope he's doing well. And we need him to get back to work as soon as possible because he has a lot of work to accomplish for the outreach committee which he heads. Are there any speakers for the public forum? If not, we'll go right into our program. And Jim, would you take care of the speakers?
Thank you very much, Harry. We're privileged today to have Lou Ann Davis come to speak with us. Lou Ann has been on the board of directors for the long-term care services of Ventura County, the Ombudsman Program. It has been Lou Ann's passion in life to let everybody know about the program, and that's why we invited her here. So without further ado, Lou Ann.
Thank you. Long-Term Care Services of Ventura County Ombudsman Program has been very interesting as far as my own association is concerned. I have thoroughly enjoyed working with the other board members and the ombudsman. We're not a government agency. We're a 501c3, which is a public benefit corporation, formed 26 years ago. We're federally mandated to do our work, but not federally funded to a level to be effective. We depend on donations, grants, and fundraising. You might be interested to know that the board hosted in 2006 our most successful fundraising project. It was fantastic. We have 4.5 staff, and that includes our executive director, who is Sylvia Taylor Stein, and 7 board members. What is an ombudsman? My own definition is somewhat different from the real one, so I'm going to give you mine first. My definition is someone with a huge heart and a deep sense of caring for the elderly and their needs. The real definition, ombudsman, is a Swedish word meaning advocate. we are long-term care ombudsmen. Different cultures take different approaches to elderly care. In Japan, the elderly are respected for their knowledge, age, experience, and are usually cared for by family members. In Africa, in the Maasai tribes, the elderly are sent out into the bush, no water, no food, obviously no long-term care. In America, we have long-term care facilities. Much of the protection for the elderly here comes in the form of our ombudsman program. What does it take to become an ombudsman? 36 hours of initial training. I went through the training so I had a better understanding of what the program was all about when I became a board member. 15 hours of field service, 12 hours each year of continuing education, and all ombudsmen are certified by the California Department of Aging. Let's talk about Thousand Oaks. You have 12 ombudsmen that represent your city, covering 47 facilities, serving 2,000 elderly residents. In the last fiscal year, we visited 3 skilled nursing facilities 164 times, 426 monitoring visits to residential care facilities for the elderly. Your ombudsman in Thousand Oaks traveled 6,117 miles during the last fiscal year, attended 46 residential council meetings, and investigated over 100 serious complaints from your area. They also participated in 26 community educational presentations. Currently, in Ventura County, we have 210 long-term care facilities with almost 8,000 residents. We currently have 53 certified ombudsmen and always looking for more. 60% of the residents in care facilities have no family or friends who ever visit them. The ombudsman may be the only friend they have for the rest of their lives. The ombudsmen are in facilities on a weekly or monthly basis where we advocate for the health and well-being of many who are too weak and frail to take care of their own needs, act in their own behalf, and look out for themselves. Our work is unduplicated, and without our presence, it is feared that most complaints and issues would go unheeded. We cannot allow the care of our elderly to deteriorate. Part of our program is our Senior Santa Project. We provide lap blankets to many residents as part of our Senior Santa program. Most of those are donated to us. This project all started in 2000 as a project of the Long-Term Care Ombudsman. Ombudsmen going in and out of care facilities all year long witnessed firsthand the emotional devastation and sadness many residents experience around the holidays. They have no family, no friends, no gifts, a sad reminder of their loneliness. Last year, I was an elf assisting Santa, who was a fellow board member. When an elderly bedridden resident grasped my arm, pulled me down close to her face, and in a very weak but raspy voice, she said, "I have only one visitor each year. I can always count on Santa." Just a few statistics for you. 40% of the people over 65 in California will spend some time in a long-term care facility. 1 in 2 people over 85 in California will spend time in a long-term care facility. Our 80-plus-year-olds are the fastest-growing sector of society at 56% per year. Our mission is helping to assure the highest quality of life and care possible for the elderly in long-term care facilities throughout Ventura County. My personal mission as a board member is to provide information about the program to as many people as I can. There are so many people unaware of the services available to assist our elderly at a time when they are confronted with the need. Please help us if you can. Become a volunteer. We need you. The elderly needs you. For more information about the program, you can go to our website, which is www.ombudsmanventura.org, or telephone us at 805-656-1986. I have a thought that I would like to leave with you today. Once upon a golden hour, upon the earth I cast a seed. I watched it grow into a flower. Some people said a weed. It's all in our perspective, isn't it? Happy to take any questions if you have them.
Anybody have any questions? Gene.
I'd just like to make a comment. We have our Senior of the Year Awards presentation tomorrow night. And two of your members, Irv Kerner and Mary Williford, are nominated for Senior of the Year. And I'd just like to personally congratulate you people and accolades to those particular nominees.
Thank you so much. Any other questions?
Roughly how many hours does a typical ombudsman spend a week?
It depends.
Yeah.
It depends. I put together some figures for you today. The 650 hours per month for the ombudsman. You can break that down to 53 ombudsmen that we have doing work. Some facilities require a little more time, other facilities a little less time.
I lost my train of thought. I'll get back to you.
Okay.
Another senior moment.
We all have those.
I'd like to make a statement, and that is I feel so fortunate to have a wonderful ombudsman program in this county. I don't know that people realize all the work that you do, and it's very unusual to have such an active ombudsman program. I know that in other counties, their ombudsmen are not as effective and really don't perform the outreach that you do. So I just want to thank you for that, because I think it's a wonderful program. And more people should know about it, because you provide a lot of services that people don't realize are available for them. And I would like you to maybe mention some of those services, because I think that they just think of you as a service that goes and surveys nursing homes and does outreach in that area. But you do a lot of outreach to the community. So if you could go over some of those services.
Absolutely. We're advocates for the people who are residents of the facilities. We attempt to make sure that their needs are met. And, of course, any complaints that they have are handled very delicately, and we attempt to remedy whatever that complaint might be. We also have an arm in our office of financial abuse. We have a complaint coordinator in our office. My own personal experience, if I could just digress for a moment, I've been doing community service for a lot of years. And in all the years that I have been doing it, I never really felt like I was making a difference. May I tell you that in the 16 months that I've been with the Ombudsman Program, I know that we make a difference, and it's such a rewarding feeling. I'm very passionate about it, and it's the first time in my life that I have felt so strongly, because the Ombudsman are fantastic. They do a phenomenal job, just a phenomenal job.
I'm very happy to report that my brain is now working.
Okay.
I wanted to know.
I'm happy.
What I wanted to ask is, as far as facilities versus people that need them, how are we doing here in Thousand Oaks or the general area? Do we have enough beds?
I think quite well, and I'm going to give you my favorite fallback expression. My partner and I know everything. That's something my partner knows. I would need to call the office. As was mentioned earlier, I've been with the program for 16 months on the board of directors. I don't have all the knowledge that I will have when I'm there for another 16 months. But we are always looking for people who are interested in helping and in becoming an ombudsman to help us. 53 people, I personally feel, are not enough. They work very hard. These are people who do it because they want to. And my personal goal would be to have another 10 ombudsmen within the next 12 months.
I was also wanting to know, as far as the number of facilities here, that assisted living places in our area, is there waiting lists? Is it difficult to get into those facilities here, even if you have the wherewithal?
I don't believe so. I haven't heard that to be the case, but I could contact Sylvia Taylor and get that information back to you.
That's all right. So it's a generalized question, because the incoming boomer generation is going to have a huge effect on bed space and the number of facilities and all that. I was just curious if you had an idea of where we sat right now.
I don't think we have a problem right now, not one that I'm aware of.
Thank you.
I'd like to address Jim's a little bit, and that is that in this particular area, there's two nursing homes that I know of, and it always depends on affordability, what you can afford as to whether there's availability of beds. And then, of course, what the need is, if it's someone that has dementia or Alzheimer's, then you're looking at something a little bit different. So it really depends on what the needs are for what's available for people. There are a lot of board and cares in the area, and that's the same with the board and care facilities. It depends on what you can afford. So there's different levels of care. So it's a hard question to answer, but I'd also like to mention, and I only know this because I still happen to be a working senior, and I work in this community. And that is, not only do you provide those types of services, but you also have a support group that people can go to. You provide support groups where people go to when they're thinking about placement. And also, I know that I have sent several clients and had them call your services to help them with making that decision, whether it's appropriate for them.
Absolutely.
And you can download the list, for anybody who'd like to know, you can download the list of all the facilities in Ventura County just by going to your website, You can get a complete up-to-date list of all the board and cares and nursing homes in the area, along with a wonderful cover sheet that addresses what the difference is between nursing home care, residential care, board and care.
Yes. So, our website is phenomenal, and there are a lot of things that can be downloaded. Absolutely, a lot of information.
Any more questions? Tom.
How do you go about recruiting people to be ombudsman volunteers, and how do you promote that?
Well, a lot of the ombudsmen have contacts and have friends who ask them about what they're doing. We recently had an ad in the newspaper. There was some response to that ad. My personal experience in the short time that I've been with the board has been I talk with people. I talk with one person, three people, five people. I have one of the ombudsman brochures on my conference table in my office. People ask about it. Most people stumble with the ombudsman, and we sort of joke about, how do you say it and what is it? Word of mouth, my goal, as I said earlier, is to talk to as many people as I can, and I always ask if they have time available, would you consider this program? We certainly have a need, and we would like to have more volunteers. Many people don't have the time to spend the entire week in the training process. I think that's the biggest barrier, but once you make the commitment to do it, that week goes by very quickly, let me tell you, and you're just stuffed full of information.
How many of the people that come to you and want to volunteer, how soon can they get into the training program? Is that ever so often, or is it ongoing?
It's
twice a year?
It's basically a demand kind of thing. I think that our director likes to have 5 or 6 people for the training session. When I did the training session, there were 8 of us. And with the exception of myself, all of the other people, I believe, went into the program, and that's after that 36 hours of training and then the mentoring part of the program where they actually go out into the facilities and then can go into a facility alone once they go through that process.
Well, there's a certification from the state involved, right? Is there a test involved with that? Or?
Absolutely. No. It's the
completion.
The completion of the time and the actual time that you're out being mentored.
Yes, Luann, our listening audience may well be interested in becoming ombudsman. That is
good.
I looked it up in the dictionary. You can also use the term ombudswoman.
Yes.
And ombudsperson.
Yes.
But they're all tough. I was just wondering if you might just give us the phone number that somebody might call if they were interested in becoming an ombudsman.
It's the phone number is 805, the number I gave you before, 805-656-1986.
Thank you very much.
And that is the office, the direct line to the ombudsman office.
Thank you.
Are there any more questions? If not, we thank you very much for your very informative talk, and we hope you'll come back again and talk to us.
Thank you so much. It was my pleasure.
We'll move down to our regularly scheduled program and committee assignments. Unfortunately, our healthcare person, Susan Poprock, isn't here, and she was going to give a talk on what to do for how to take care of yourself in summer, and I've called upon Dr. Tom here to read her report. Thank you, if you will.
Thank you. Just a comment before I start. I was in Lyon, France, several years ago for a wedding of my lovely niece, and they happened to have had a terrible heat wave that struck the city and all of the countryside of from Paris all the way down to Marseille. I didn't really understand how terrible that could be until I learned that an actual world-famous soccer player died on the soccer field because of heat exhaustion on the day they played. Not only was that the only mortality, but hundreds of people died throughout France during that heat wave, and it really impacted me quite a bit. I had no idea that it was so serious a problem. Hot weather concerns for senior adults, these are heat-related illnesses, and they can be life-threatening for seniors and others. Heat stress, heat exhaustion, and heat stroke are the most common types of heat-related illness. Heat stress, for example, is the burden that hot weather places on your body, and especially on your heart. Our bodies respond to hot weather by increasing blood flow to the skin, and then we sweat, which is something a lot of people don't like, but this evaporating sweat carries away excess body heat. This helps us to keep a normal body temperature, and that's good. During very hot weather, we sweat more as our bodies work even harder to keep the normal temperature that we have to have. High humidity coupled with high temperatures increases the stress on our bodies because it slows down this evaporation process. Senior adults are frequently more vulnerable to heat stress than younger people because their bodies do not adjust as well to heat-related conditions. They perspire less, which prevents the body from cooling itself. Many medications also affect the body's natural ability to adjust to heat. For example, diuretics often prescribed for high blood pressure, prevent the body from storing fluids, and restrict the opening of blood vessels near the skin surface. Certain tranquilizers and drugs used to treat Parkinson's disease, for example, will interfere with perspiring. Chronic conditions such as circulatory problems, diabetes, or even a previous stroke, or a damaged heart also upset the body's normal normal responses. So when a person has been exposed to the sun or heat for an extended period of time, they can be at risk for heat exhaustion. This overexposure causes the body to perspire heavily, removing fluids from the body. Symptoms of heat exhaustion, they include pale, cool, moist skin, increased pulse, and muscle cramps, and even confusion. So it's good to notice these things happening and take action. A heat stroke, by the way, is the most dangerous type of heat-related illness. It occurs when an individual is exposed to excessive heat over a long period of time. The body loses the ability to regulate its temperature, making it difficult to cool the body down. Symptoms can be similar to heat exhaustion. However, they may be accompanied by a high fever and no perspiration. So heat strokes are a medical emergency and they can be fatal. They really need to be treated immediately and get into a hospital urgent care center or something of that nature, even the emergency room at the hospital. What are these warning signals of heat-related illnesses? Well, early signs of heat stress may be the loss of appetite and feeling listless and uncomfortable. Serious signs of possible heat stroke, which require immediate medical attention, include dizziness, deepening urine colors, rapid heartbeat, diarrhea, nausea, cramps, throbbing headaches, dry skin with no sweating, chest pain, even changes in your mental or emotional state, or breathing problems, and even vomiting. These problems are really significant, and the one thing that you need to know is how can you remain safe and comfortable during this hot weather season that's approaching? Obviously, it could be even worse than usual because we have global warming, and we have predictably, at least in the Southwest, dry temperatures that are supposed to be coming our way because of problems with no rain and just a climate that does not seem conducive to having much of anything but heat during the summer. So what can you do? Well, drink iced and other fluids in sufficient quantities to make sure that you do not become dehydrated. Keep some fans in your home, and if you don't have air conditioning, those fans come in tremendously helpful. You might even want to spray a little bit of spray water on yourself when the fan is going. It immediately cools down the body temperature much faster. Fans should be cleaned and inspected regularly, of course, and they should also have protective covers that be placed in a location that protects you from any kind of injury. It may be helpful to place these fans in a location that brings cooler outside air into the building when temperatures drop after sunset. You want to close the drapes, the curtains, and the shades in areas that are exposed to direct sunlight. Baths and showers in tepid water or even an ice bag or a wet towel can help reduce the individual's internal temperature. So wear loose clothing and even lightweight clothing. Limit the amount of physical activities, of course, especially if you're outdoors. And avoid hot and heavy meals because they can only add body heat. Limit the use of salt and avoid alcohol. Both of those can cause the body to lose necessary water because they act as a dehydrating effect on the body. So in summary, we'd like for you all to just stay cool and enjoy the summer months. And thank you for letting me make this report.
Thank you. Anybody have anything to add?
Harry?
Yes, Connie.
I would like to add, because it is our last meeting before we break for the summer, and all year for the last 9 months we've been talking about several different areas, but primarily in the area of health. I think most of our talks have been around, you know, taking better care of yourself and making yourself a priority in your life. And especially as we age, we have a tendency to take care of everybody else but ourselves. And so I just want to remind people that yourself is a priority. You need to take care of yourself before you can take care of anyone else. And one little thing that I'd like to mention here is in the AARP magazine, and I'm not advocating AARP, but what I am saying that they have a wonderful article in the AARP June magazine on getting stronger and living longer. And so I'd like to just address some of the areas that they mention in this magazine, which is one of the primary focuses to eat well for strength. And, of course, like was mentioned, drinking a lot of water, drinking enough water, especially in the summer months, is really very important. So the title is Wet Your Whistle with Water. And then using a steamer for cooking your food is a good way to preserve a lot of the nutrients in your food, using a steamer rather than frying your food and eating a lot of vegetables. Eat less, but eat more often, the latest trend now, and of course it has been for a long time, but we're hearing more and more about it, is eating smaller meals, smaller portions, 5 times a day, rather than eating three healthy meals. And of course, not eating late at night. And then getting yourself moving, exercise. And exercise can be just taking a small walk. It could be going in the pool and exercising in the pool, whatever works for you. But in whatever exercise you can find, fit into your lifestyle. But fit it into your lifestyle at least 3 days a week. And then one thing I think that we forget about, and that is reaching out to a friend. Reaching out to a friend sometimes is real helpful, not only for that person, but for yourself. Or making a new friend. And a new friend could be calling your neighbor next door, talking to a family member that maybe you haven't spoke to in a long time, sending an email or writing a letter, or visiting somebody in need, or making a new friend through an animal. We're reading a lot of stories about dogs and cats that need homes and need a friend. Well, there's a friend that'll be a lifelong friend for you. So maybe rescue an animal and bring them into your home and give them the love that maybe your children are grown and they're away from your home now and you're kind of alone and you need someone to love. And they will give you unconditional love. So whatever works for you, take good care of yourself. Have a happy, healthy summer. And we hope to see you again in September. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. We appreciate those comments. Moving on to housing, does anybody here have any report on housing? Unfortunately, I tried to contact Russ Watkins for his report, which he gave on a recent program called Picking Up the Pieces, which was on affordable housing, and he had a very good summary of what the city has accomplished in the past year in the way of affordable housing. And I think it would have been very good for this program and for the seniors who are watching or listening. Anyway, I don't have it. I'm sorry, but I will have it next time, and that will be in the fall, of course. And more things will have happened since then, so I'll most likely include whatever is in that report. Moving on to programs and public information.
Yeah, as you mentioned earlier, Harry, and as Tony just mentioned, since we're going to be breaking for the summer and returning in September we will have a speaker from the Hospice of the Conejo, and they're going to tell us about their ongoing programs, plus a brand-new program they're starting called Vigil. You'll learn more about that when September comes. And also, again, as Harry mentioned, Deputy Larry Logan will be talking to us about fraud, identity theft, and the like. We are going to discuss a lot of the same general categories next year that we discussed this year. Affordable housing, just like Harry mentioned. Transportation is always we always have a speaker or a panel of speakers together for the transportation issue. Fraud, elder abuse, health, of course. But one of the things I'd like to ask you out there, if you have something that you would like to hear a speaker talk about, if there's an issue that's bugging you or your friends or your organization, please let us know that. I mean, we're very, very concerned about doing what you want us to do. rather than what we think you want us to do. So if anybody out there, organization or an individual, has a particular subject that they would like to discuss with us, I'm looking for a phone number here. Francine, give me your phone number, 449-2143. 2743, 449-2743. Let Francine Spiegel know, and by golly, we'll do our best to bring that kind of a speaker to our cameras. That's all we have planned for next year. We have, again, this break during the summer. We will be meeting as committees, even though we won't be doing our televised programs. So any input that you might have during the summer, Francine would just be tickled pink to hear it and write it down and get it into our grubby little hands. I'll say that again. Council on Aging at to.org. T-O-T-Oaks.org. Boy, that ought to be on a scroll, shouldn't it? Council on Aging at toaks.org. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim. I'd like to echo his comments and try to impress on our viewing audience that we want to be your voice at City Council. And if we don't have you to tell us what your issues and concerns are, what can we bring to City Council? And, you know, and we need your input. So just be aware that we're there for you. Now, next up on the list is Outreach Committee, which I think Mel is the chair of, and he is not here. But who is Jim?
Let me say a couple of little things about Outreach. Yeah, we've been talking about Outreach to you folks for some time, and the concept, very quickly, is that we want to come out and get involved with you, your organizations, talk about what's going on in terms of services and facilities and programs for seniors, bring you up to date as much as we can on resource information, and to listen to you. So please, we will be coming out probably starting in the fall. One of the things that we as a council had to accomplish was we had to get approval from the City Council, which just happened last month, unanimously, I might add. They're very, very enthusiastic about our getting out to visit with you people. So, again, this is kind of getting to sound like a recorded message, but if you are an organization, a church, the Elks, a homeowners association, if you run an HP group at your work, and you'd like to get up to date on what's coming down with all the resources and facilities for seniors and what to do about the future with the incoming boomers, give us a call. Use that same number. And again, that's 449-2743. And the number in Jersey is. So that's all I have to say about outreach. You'll be hearing a lot more about that when we reconvene. We will be meeting as an outreach committee during our absences and working on our plans to get out and talk with you and inform you and listen to you. Thank you.
Don't hang up yet, Jim. You're going to talk about Senior of the Year.
Oh, boy, this is exciting. Senior of the Year is a big deal. It's one of our major events, and it's going to take place tomorrow evening. It's at the Goble Center at 6 o'clock. And what we are doing is that we, the City of Thousand Oaks Council on Aging, every year take nominees for the Senior of the Year. And these are people who spend an inordinate amount of time doing good in our community. It is absolutely overwhelmingly heartwarming to read these people's bios. They do so much to make life better for you and me. And we're going to honor these people, and one of them will be selected Senior of the Year. This year we had the great privilege of having 9 very, very capable nominees, and I'd like to read their names for you. Bud Campbell, Arlene Narkin, Bob Fitch, Edward Francis, Irv Kerner, Ida Lee, Joe LeWalt, and Dottie LeWalt, and Mary Williford. Now, what we're going to do tomorrow night, in addition to honoring these people, is we're going to have some fine pasta food from the good folks at Amici's, and we're going to have dancing and music from the big band sounds of the Unforgettables. And all of this is going to cost you a ridiculously low price of $3. I think there are some tickets available. I know it's done pretty well. There's only a few left. But if you have the time and want to have a really good time and honor some really, really wonderful folks, come on down to the Goebel Center tomorrow night. Thank you. I'd also like to mention a little bit about some of the other things that that we do here on our monthly meeting. We've mentioned our outreach, and we're going to get out and want to talk to you. We want to get your ideas about what do you think the future's going to look like when the baby boomers start hitting our coffers. But in addition to that, we'd like to share some of the good times that go on in our community. So if you have, if your organization has an event coming up and you want to get a little pub for that, come on down to the boardroom here at City Hall the first Wednesday of every month and get up in front of our TV cameras and tell us all about it. Or you can use that same number, and again, that number is 449-2743, and call us if you have a special anniversary or a birthday or something like that coming up. If you can't get down here, we'll announce it. We want to celebrate the good times as well as all the things that we have as problems on our plate. So give that number a call. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim. Do we have anything in transportation at this time? I guess there's no report. Anything on legislation? Mark that as a no report. Fraud. Martin?
Yes, Harry. I have three new items to report on. I've named this first one the Nigerian puppy scam. Remember the original Nigerian scam is where somebody would contact you looking for an honest man that will help him spirit millions of dollars out of the country? Well, in this one, you get an email with pictures of little puppies that need a home. And if you volunteer to provide this home, they will ask you for $100 to pay for the shipping. If you send them the $100, next he will ask you for $200 to handle the shots and the paperwork. And if you respond to that one, he'll keep on this way until he runs out of ideas or you run out of money. Whichever comes first. It's a scam. There are no puppies. He doesn't have any puppies, but the pictures are very cute. A more dangerous problem is a report that we got from the Ventura County Sheriff. There are couples, sometimes with children, who come to the door and act as if they've known you your entire life, and they know your name and your relatives' names, your friends' names, and they kind of walk right in, sit down in your living room, and just carry on a conversation like they've known you forever. Then one of them will ask if they can use your bathroom, and that is their opportunity to go through your house and find whatever it is that looks like valuable enough to steal. So far, there has been no violence involved, but this is a very dangerous situation. Be very careful when you open that door. We all have those little peepholes in our door. How many of us really use them when that doorbell rings? Be careful. So far, no one's been caught, so these people are still going around the county. And finally, now that the income tax season is over, you may get an email from the IRS about a problem with your tax return. And if you would like the details of this problem, you have to download an attachment to the email. Don't do that. That attachment will put a program into your computer that will give the scammer an opportunity to get in there and steal whatever, you know, private information you may have. The IRS does not send you notices by email. If they want you, they will use first-class letters. They don't pay postage, so they can do that. Don't respond to emails, but pay attention to those letters.
Okay. Thank you, Martin. One correction. While the IRS does send out letters, they do pay postage, but they don't pay it per letter.
They have a system where the
postage is charged against them, so it's not free. We pay for it in the end.
We pay for it.
Disaster emergency preparedness. Do we have any report today? Okay. If not, we'll move on to liaison reports, and I'll turn the meeting over to Gene.
Yes. I'm going to call on Commissioner Jim Sheridan to talk about the Ventura County area aging.
Yeah, thank you, Gene. I think Mel discussed last month that the VCAAA, the Ventura County Area Agency on Aging, by the way, it's not real easy to say real fast, is we're redoing the bylaws, and there will be some structural changes in how we do our meetings. And I think the reason that I would want to even mention it is that it's going to be a lot more efficient. We're going to be breaking up and doing a lot more committee work and actual rolling up your sleeves type work. And I think we're going to get a lot more information to return to our general meetings. There are some other little changes, but they're mostly minutia involving the VCAAA. I did attend a task force meeting last week where we reviewed and recommended approving approximately $230,000 worth of new grants. And these are grants primarily in the Title III B and Title III E category, such things as adult daycare, a companionship grant, in-home services, family caregiving, kinship care counseling, home modification, that sort of thing. We had basically, I think, 13 new requests for grants, and we reviewed those all and spread out the money as well as we could. But those will normally go as a recommendation up to the Board of Supervisors, who most generally will approve those. So there will be new money into the system for those sorts of categories. That's all. Thank you.
The Retired Senior Volunteer Program, RSVP program, I have with me an article in the Thousand Oaks Acorn I'd like to share with you. The volunteerism in the United States has decreased most recently. And in Thousand Oaks, according to the Acorn, it's decreased by about 3% in 2006. However, in California, that is. In Thousand Oaks, however, we have an increase in volunteerism. According to Cindy Powers, the number of volunteers has increased by 10% over the last 5 years here in Thousand Oaks. So we ought to thank all of our volunteers publicly and keep up the good work. I'd like now to turn it over to Commissioner Marty Shentis.
Thank you, Jane. First of all, RSVP will help you file for homeowners and renters assistance on Thursday mornings beginning on June 21st, and it ends on August 30th. And if you were eligible to file last year but did not, you can come in on June 21st or the 28th, and they will help you file for both last year and this year. And the deadline for filing for last year is June 30th. To be eligible, you must be, as of December 31st, 2006, over 62 or blind or disabled. You must have lived in your own home or rented with over $50 per month rent. Your total household income must be around $42,770 or less, including your Social Security. And if you are eligible, you should bring on those Thursday mornings your federal income tax return, your IRS form SSA 1099 for Social Security benefits. If you rent, your landlord's name and address. If you own your home, the county property tax bill, and proof of your age, like a birth certificate or a driver's license or a passport. Now, RSVP is also in desperate need, they say, for drivers for the Meals on Wheels program. They also need callers for their bingo games on Tuesdays, Fridays, and Saturdays between 1 and 3 p.m. finally, and what the cutest thing is, that makeup, RSVP makes cute little pillows like this. They're given to needy children and children in hospice care. The materials they use are all donated, and volunteers cut out the materials into these patterns and sew them up. What they need are people to draw the pictures, the faces, and the costumes on these little dolls. So if you have the ability and the desire to draw these little things, they would certainly appreciate your volunteering. You can do these drawings at the senior center, or you can actually do them in your own home. And if you're interested, please call RSVP, and their number for any of these things, their number is 381-2742. That's 381-2742. Thank you. Oh, I don't get to keep this, by the way. I have to give it back.
Our final report is from Andrea Koval of the Global Senior Adult Center, who was unable to make it today. Let me tell you about a new program, however, at the Global Senior Adult Center. We've established a program there that is called the Ambassador Program. What it amounts to is we have a great number of people in Thousand Oaks who are seniors who really don't know much about the Global Senior Adult Center. They sometimes come to the center, and if you visited the center, they're the people you see who look like sort of deers in the headlights. They have usually a monthly newsletter, and they're walking around. They don't know where anything is. A great number of people don't realize that the Global Senior Adult Center is a very active, vital organization that has all kinds of activities that are available. Now, the new ambassador program that has just been initiated will allow a person who does not know about the Global Senior Adult Center either come to the center and go to the desk in the front and pick up a monthly newsletter, and at the same time mention to the receptionist that you are new to the area or that you don't know much about the Global Center. And if you leave your phone number, one of the ambassadors from the center will call you, make an appointment with you to come to the center, and provide for you a complete orientation program. Walk around, tell you all about the program, and hopefully, if you have the time, invite you to have lunch there at the center. So please come to the center. If you're unable to come there for that, please give a call. That telephone number, local number, is 381-2744. That's 381-2744. At that time, say you are interested in an orientation at the center, and one of the ambassadors will call you and make arrangements for an appointment to complete a complete orientation for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Gene. Okay. Any old business before this commission? None? Any new business?
Harry, I would just like to, if I can just mention...
if you're going to make a comment, would you please hold them to the comments portion?
You sure can. I sure can.
Okay, thank you.
It's difficult, you know, with a woman, you know.
I don't know how to respond to that, so I guess I shouldn't.
Oh, sure you do.
I thought I'd throw that in there.
Exactly. Okay. Okay, now we come to commissioners' comments. Tony?
Thank you, sir. I just want to remind everyone that when you go to the Senior Global Center, please pick up your Senior Services Directory if you haven't got one already. They're wonderful. They have a lot of the resources that are available in the Kaneo Valley area, Thousand Oaks area, to meet your needs. So please pick one up. If they don't have them, you can also call... the number for the Council on the Aging number, which is 449-2743, and get your copy. And also, if you have any questions or concerns that you really don't know where the resource for it is, and you for social services or any health care needs, there is a number that you can call, which is 211. Dial 211, and someone will answer that phone and help you out with the resource that you're looking for. That's it.
Thank you, Tony. Okay, we got that away. I have a couple of announcements for the Teen Center. On Saturday, June 9th at 1 p.m. at the Grant Grimhall Library, the Teen Center is putting on a night at the museum. It's a free movie, so if you want to attend that, be there at 1 p.m. And also on Monday, June 11th, the Teen Center is also putting on for free The Queen, with starring Oscar winner Helen Mirren. So again, at 1 p.m. on Monday, June 11th, auspices of the Teen Center. And I guess if there are no more comments, we'll declare the meeting adjourned.